The 21st century college learning team has been looking at the big picture and trying to decide where to next. Trying to make sure that the professional learning that we provide to you is as cutting edge as possible, that it integrates teaching and learning strategies, and that it helps you to maximise student learning outcomes. Wray Needs from the Wall's End campus is here to present a presentation based on a number of in-services that he's been to, primarily EduTech, but certainly other workshops that he's been to along the way. And the focus question is, are we leaning the ladder against the right wall? Will you welcome Wray, please?
Now, I thought
because I've returned to my alma mater today, that we might do a little bit of a history journey as well, and have a look at the way some things have changed. Some things obviously haven't changed in teaching and learning, and a good deal is yet to change. So if you have a look at these fine gentlemen, I was born in 56. Some of you who work here may recognise the brickwork behind those guys. I'd just like you to think for a moment what sort of vibe you get from the staff photo, 1957. We have Hitler there, just after the war. We have an early model there, the Dobby, out of... I won't point to him, but we also have my first high school maths teacher. I got into boys' high, which meant that in primary school, my maths was reasonably okay. Thanks to one of the gentlemen there, I can barely... Well, I won't tell you how bad my maths is now. So some things have changed. Look at the rebel up here. Doesn't even have a coat on. Where are the girls? Oh. I'm not saying that when I was here, the student body was entirely resistant to change. But if you give kids Vickers machine guns, there's a certain amount of maybe resistance there. We had our traditions, we were very, very proud of it. And the old fellows in the coats and the ties saw no reason to change. Some of them didn't change their jacket by the time I got there 15 years later or whatever. You would have looked like some of these guys. Don't worry, I wasn't silly enough to put my photo up there, but that's what year 10 would have looked like. I was very, very fortunate when I was in year 10 because I had this fellow for English, a fellow called Vic Rooney. And he was one of those teachers who was a legend, yeah? He was one of those teachers that hopefully many of us here aspire to be. And one thing that I'd like you to take away from the session today is the fact that each and every one of you sitting here has the capacity and the propensity to change kids' lives. Things that Vic, let's call him Vic, because that's his name. Things that Vic did in English with my class have stayed with me and have helped me to actually become the adult that I became. So, bad on Vic. I want you to remember that in your classrooms, in your faculties, in your schools, on a daily basis, you are setting up the future. And not just the future for the next 2 years after the kids get through their next exam, but the future of those kids for maybe the next 40 or 50 years. Because here I am, years later, and I'm still trying to channel Vic because he had such a huge impression on me. So keep that in mind, please, people. Well, I'll just let you ponder that for a moment. So, what has changed in the intervening 43 years? Well, dress sense has gone out the window. Yeah? You call that a staff photo? However, I think you can probably see there what a factor, eh? Strong stuff. You can see there some imagination, some creativity, some people who are willing to set themselves up to look absolutely ridiculous and not care about it. And that's something that we should all remember in our classroom. We can fail, we can do the wrong thing, we can make a mistake, we can look ridiculous, and it doesn't matter. On the right hand side, my current year 10, or most of them, and looking at them, who could not want to do
the very best that you could do for them. There's so much potential in our students. However, lots of things have stayed the same. Currently, in my English class with these guys, I'm doing exactly the same text that I did with Vic 43 years ago. Fair enough. Hopefully, I'm doing it in an entirely different way. Vic didn't have the technology. All Vic had really was the power of his personality and a passion for what he was doing. And remember, as the most important person in the room, sometimes, or most of the time, that's all you need. I'll just go back. Set this one up. Now, being a fairly influential college, having great leadership, we do have a certain amount of influence. And I'm very, very lucky today to be able to bring to you first sightings of the Abbott government's new media release, the vision for Australia's future education. Okay? So, think yourself lucky. In response to flagging NAPLAN results, in response to average HSC results, here is what we can envisage our current government providing us for the future.
Are you happy about the school, Mrs. Smith?
Yes, thank you. But I wonder if you could tell me more about schooling in Australia.
Why, certainly. If your boy had been a little younger, he might have gone to a kindergarten. But now that he's six, he must start work in the infants department. We aim to teach the child through all his senses, not just from books. We encourage children to tackle problems by using their sense of sight, hearing, and touch. That way, too, they learn to think.
Spaces are going to be the thing of the future in Australian education. What else do we have on offer?
It's by new schools planned for more space with large windows, making the most of sunshine and fresh air. Now, when the child is 8 or 9 years old, we begin to place more emphasis on what you just called formal studies: history, geography, mathematics, English, and so forth. This means harder work, but the child's training in the infants department has prepared him for it. Today, we can bring the outside world into the classroom by the use of aids like film and radio.
Of our present, or reminds of us of our past, Hopefully we're sitting here going, that's absolutely ridiculous. There is nothing in there that is familiar to me. You notice the quality teaching record.
In the cities, girls and boys generally go to separate secondary schools. But in the country, most secondary schools are attended by both girls and boys. Private schools and state government schools have the same courses and examinations.
I've made lots of friends since coming to high school, and I like the work too. We have biology and science, and lots of subjects we never thought of at primary school, like languages. I'm taking French.
Au milieu d'une forêt. Au milieu d'une forêt. Demeurait une vieille sorte.
That one's basically just in there for spacing, really. Okay? But again, are we seeing practices that are new to us, common to us, or abhorrent to us?
Speech Day is a summing up of the year's work and a turning point for many students. Parents and teachers are equally concerned in the results of their work.
Today marks the end of the school year. For many of you, it will be the end of your schooling. Our aim has been to give you a well-balanced all-round education. You have learned to think, you have developed strong, healthy bodies, and you have acquired the scientific and technical skills needed in this complex world today. Many of you will be going to university. Many of you will be going out into jobs. All of you will soon be taking your place as citizens in the community. Your places in this class, in these classrooms, will be taken by other young Australians and the children of those new Australians who are coming here from lands overseas. Like you, they will have the opportunity of all that Australian education has to offer. Like you, they will go out into the world with confidence to shape their own future. With you, they will share the responsibility of building the Australia of tomorrow.
Changed me. 3 decades of doing the same sort of thing. I'd like you to imagine now the principal standing up and giving the end of the year speech to our students, the students of the future, our 21st century learners. And in addition to, well, we've taught you to think. Some of you go to uni, all of you will get a job. Most of you will finish your education now, you'll have your bit, and you've got healthy bodies. In addition to that, his speech might go a little bit longer for the 21st century learner, because he'd be wanting to add, you've all become self-directed learners. You are now all globally aware. You are great communicators. You are terrific problem solvers. I have critical thinkers sitting in front of me. You're collaborators. You're civically engaged. You are information and media literate. Financially and economically literate. I wish someone had done that with me when I was at school. I wouldn't be standing here now. You are a group of innovators. His speech would need to go half an hour longer just to tick off the new valuable skills that we need to provide our students now. Ah, For a moment, we get back to the ladder. Okay? These three gentlemen all attended Boys High, all went to that particular year, that cohort. Okay? Peter on the left is a head teacher, and he's a head teacher 3 hours up north at a school, let's call it Backwater High. Okay? Now, I haven't seen Peter for a very, very long time, but I know that he's a genuine hard worker, and he would do everything within his power to give his students an advantage in their education. Okay? But when we met up for the first time in decades, and I was having a chat after a couple of hours with Peter, started to talk to him about how's your school doing with 21st century learning, his response was something like, not a problem. I got my faculty an interactive whiteboard. We're sweet. Okay? So, that school, not far up the coast, still hasn't seen the imperative that we have for change. They haven't put the technology in. They're not interested in BYOD. They wouldn't know 21st century learning if I came and pointed a laser pointer at them. Not that they're not good teachers, but they haven't taken the steps that we have taken probably in the last 5 years and continue to need to take. So Peter's kind of like Manuel in the ladder metaphor. The guy who might have been interested at the bottom of the ladder, but someone said to him, mate, you don't need to know this, don't follow me up the ladder. You'll be quite happy with your lot. Yeah? The guy in the middle, Basil, climbing the ladder, being frustrated when he gets to the top. Yeah? Tap, 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 where's the curriculum change? Tap, 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 where's the pedagogy? Tap, 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 oh, the network's down. The guy on the right is a different kettle of fish because he turned himself into a 21st century learner before the 21st century. Okay? I went to school with him, his name's Peter Watchon. And when he finished school, he didn't do what Peter and I did, go into a job where everything was provided for you. Peter said, I'm going to make my own way. He went to the con to learn music. And when he went to the con, he had in mind that what he wanted to do was he wanted to record all of Bach's works, everything that Bach had ever written, including a few shopping lists that were... So when he got to the con said to him, that's fabulous. What do you want to do? Pete said, I want to learn the harpsichord. Lovely, you don't have one. So Peter said, oh, fair enough. I'll build one for you. So Peter built the instrument for the con so that he could follow his passion, his dream. When he finished that, he ends up in America and he doesn't have an outlet for all of the Bach and all of the classical music that he wants to record. So he creates his own recording company called Omnia Music, which specialises in recording classical music. And last year, he eventually locked it in and he finished recording the entire works of Bach. And he's been all of those 20th century types of things in order to achieve what he wanted to achieve, to follow his passion, to, as we saw Sir Ken talking about, work with his natural creativity. And I keep climbing the ladder. So, just very, very quickly, just to remind us that we do live in a very, very different world to the fellows who taught me, the guys I went to school with. The world has changed and will continue to change. And that change will be driven by numerous trends, like the democratisation of knowledge, You know, the availability of knowledge online, everywhere, 24/7. Mass expansion of access to education. It'll also be driven by competition for students and very tight budgets, as we're constantly being reminded. Digital technologies. We know that. We know that digital technologies are going to drive change across society. And at this school, we have a huge involvement in that change. Whether it's enough, I'm not sure. I think maybe we could do better. The industrial age has changed to the information age. Globalisation, changes in communication, ageing population. Put your hand up if you were under 36 years, 8 months, what was it, 10 days, and put your hand up if you are under that age. Put your hand down. You are the future. Thank goodness. Decreasing birth rate will have an influence. Tech change again. It's going to change every 2 years. There's going to be that exponential growth every 2 years for the foreseeable future. Protection of climate, environment, biodiversity and sustainability. These are layers of influence that did not exist during my education. They certainly do now. And unfortunately, the last one there, security of business, terrorist activity, those types of things are having an impact, even in their classrooms in Australia and certain regions. Now, I want to point out to you that this is not my opinion. I'm not sprouting my own personal slant on things. In 2012, half a handful of years ago, Dr. Michelle, our boss of bosses, yeah, if you want to know about what's supposed to happen in New South Wales education, she's your lady. What does she say we're supposed to be doing? Well, she talks about education is a high-stakes enterprise. Students are competing on a global stage. New skills are needed. We talk about the four C's. They're embedded, supposedly embedded, in everything that we do. Creativity, communication, collaboration, and critical thinking. The rate of change is so rapid. To be successful in the 21st century, they will need the ability to think both creatively and critically. Problem solve, work collaboratively. Our challenge will be to constantly adapt. And that's what I want you to do. That's what I want you to keep in your mind now, for the next 5 years, the next 10 years, the next 20 years. I won't be there to see it, but you will be there, well, at least those of you who put up your hand and said, you know, I'm less than 36. Constant change. Or, like Backwater High up the road, you could do this. But if we do that, we might remain in our comfort zone. But as Michelle said there, Dr. Michelle said there, we're not here for us. We are here to place our students at the forefront of everything that we do. Hopefully that will come back on in a sec. Now, Graham mentioned that I'm fortunate enough to get sent off to a number of conferences, etc. At the last EduTech conference, one of the keynote presenters came and spoke for a while. She was the founding member of an international think tank about education, and she was also talking about the imperative of change. And the most powerful thing that she did was show this video clip to to the 6,000 educators who were sitting in her audience. And hopefully if I could that again. Systems worldwide that are going to prepare our future citizens for that world if they are going to inherit. Show me the exam that you can pass to be prepared and make the changes necessary in that world. So, I've got a lot of landmarks. I've been to a lot of places and heard a lot of wonderful people. I've been in the room, as Graham said before. I've had conversations with these people. Ewan McIntosh, Jukes, Eric Mazur, Mitra, Sir Ken, Super Awesome Sylvia. Well, I started a conversation with her, but then security grabbed me. And in those many hours, I have not heard any of those incredibly fine thinkers about education ever say anything along the lines of 21st century learning is applicable and useful and valuable unless your kids have to do an exam. So don't do it if there's nap land at the end of the year. Throw it out and concentrate on the exam or the HSC. It doesn't work, 21st century. I've never heard them say that. I have heard them. Talk about this, however, and I'd like to make a little confession at the moment. Do we remember this fella? Children. I call him Gold Man. Okay. On the right-hand side, we have Strap-On Boy. Now, these are probably terms that you're unfamiliar with, and you might say to use only in the company of other educators. I'm embarrassed to say that after 5 or 6 years of climbing that ladder of 21st century learner, I'm no better, really, than Knock Man and Strap-On Boy. Because in a lot of my lessons, I am not getting to true 21st century learning. I'm just scratching the surface. I'm just strapping on the technology and playing with the Google Docs. Simon, don't go there. Okay? And it hurts because it's not what's supposed to be happening. I do apologise to the Canadian. It's not his fault. But we need to be doing better than that. That's the ladder on a good wall. It's certainly a good wall. The technology wall is certainly a strong, solid wall. Okay? However, the technology ladder needs to lead us to deeper learning, to true 21st century learning, rather than just dicking around with technology. So I ask you to have faith in 21st century learning. There's pressure always when test results aren't good or retention rates aren't good or whatever it is isn't good. There's pressure to go back to that which is familiar. Please don't. Okay? Read the yellow bit. Too late. I'm running out of time. Read the yellow bit. Someone throw a hand up and they're done. Good. Read the yellow and red bit. Someone throw their hand up. And Graham, don't just do it because you want to feel superior. Okay? Can't see that. Only through engaging kids in high order thinking activities do they really have any chance of breaking through those achievement barriers that are created by just drilling and testing. Recognize it. Everybody. Some sort of consistency. We need to work towards flipping classrooms across the whole school or the whole college. We need to work on maybe project-based learning for all and sundry. Okay?
Well, I do. And I meet all kinds of people who don't enjoy what they do. They simply go through their lives getting on with it. They get no great pleasure from what they do. They endure it rather than enjoy it and wait for the weekend. But I also meet people who love what they do and couldn't imagine doing anything else. If you said to them, don't do this anymore, they'd wonder what you're talking about. Because it isn't what they do, it's who they are. They say, but this is me. You know, it would be foolish for me to abandon this because it speaks to my most authentic self. And it's not true of enough people. In fact, on the contrary, I think it's still true of a minority of people. And I think there are many possible explanations for it. And high among them is education. Because education, in a way, dislocates very many people from their natural talents. And human resources are like natural resources. They're often buried deep. You have to go looking for them. They're not just lying around on the surface. You have to create the circumstances where they show themselves. And you might imagine education would be the way that happens, but too often, it's not. Every education system in the world is being reformed at the moment, and it's not enough. Reform is no use anymore, because that's simply improving a broken model. What we need, and the word's been used many times during the course of the past few days, is not...
I'm weary of the time frame. He goes on to talk about the fact that change is difficult, it's challenging, and it's very, very easy for people to come at change from a position of, why bother? We've always done it this way. And of course, we've had a smorgasbord of Ken today. And I hope that many, many people in the room are willing to not say, why bother? We've always done it that way. We'll keep doing it that way. I'm hoping that people in the room will be saying, I don't know what the change is necessarily going to be, but I want to be part of it. I want to be driving the change. I want to be in control of the change. Otherwise, the change will be foisted upon me. So, with the idea of change in mind, I'll just finish very, very quickly with a couple of large changes that are happening in education systems in the world at the moment. One school in Adelaide, we'll have a quick look at it. Okay, Fremantle Elizabeth City High School this year have looked at themselves and said, not happy, it's not working, right? So what they've decided to do is they're going to replace years 8 to 10 with academic streams based on students' progress rather than age, okay? Surely that can't be a bad idea. What's interesting, however, is that they're willing to do the change and the principal says it can't be a 5 to 10 year process. We're already 5 years down the track in climbing our ladder of 21st century learning. This boss says we're going to make a big change and it can't be something that's going to take 10 years. It needs to happen now. Otherwise, we have a generation of students that miss out. He also says we have pockets of greatness across the entire school. And I've been around these three campuses, and I've been to things like this with you guys, and I would stand here and I would swear on a stack of Bibles that we have that. We have pockets of greatness in each of our campuses, in each of our faculties. Talented kids and staff with great skills, but at the moment, we still lack that consistency.
Finland.
So, strap-on technology doesn't make 21st century learning. It's a good ladder, the technology, yeah? It's a good foundation. We can climb a long way with the technology.
Ground control, but to make
it's not the end.
Ground control to Major Tom.
We need to be willing to make other changes. Pedagogy, curriculum,
take your protein pills
and your
timetable,
whatever it takes.
Ground control to Major Tom.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, there are more days there. I don't have time to go. If you're sitting there thinking, Wray is full of the proverbial, and I'm quite happy to be Manuel being told to get off the ladder, or I'm quite happy working at Backwater High, it doesn't concern me, please come and have a chat with me after the session, because I also run retirement seminars, okay? The change is going to come and bite you guys. You may as well be driving. Thank you very much, I'm out of here. Try the video.